So, welcome to the Puppet Camp, to my presentation, Puppet Get It Started. First, one organizational question. Someone here who prefers me to do it in English? If someone says yes, I will do it in English. If no, I will do it in German.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so in English. Come in. So, what will I cover in the next 2.5 hours? First, I will give a really brief introduction into NetWays and into my person. Then, an introduction in configuration management and how Puppet works on this topic. Then, different components you will see in the Puppet environment. Then some ideas about how to design your environment, how to design your workflow, and at least some ideas about designing your modules. Just feel free to ask questions, to interrupt me if something is unclear or you want me to explain something more. So just feel free to ask. So, brief introduction. NetWays, the company I work for, the company who is organizing this conference. We were founded in 1995, doing open source from 1997. We are about 40 employees at the moment, doing open source system management, data center management. And I'm a consultant at the company, doing Isinga monitoring and Puppet config management, doing also the trainings. So doing trainings for Isinga, for Puppet. Next year we will have some trainings for Logstash and so on. Just one slide with the conferences. So this Puppet Camp, we have 170 attendees. Then last in April, we were 110. So this is a really growing topic. And we hope to see you next year in April in Berlin. And also, the 3 days before that will be our open source data center conference covering different topics, 2 tracks of presentations and workshops, and perhaps you are also interested in them. So, I said a really brief introduction, so we come to the topic. Configuration management, it's all about automation. You have your different types of automation. You manually configure your systems. You use some self-made scripts like this SSH loop. You can use some golden images, so it always provides the same. You can use different software solutions. There are many on the market, commercial products, but yes, we want to talk about Puppet. So Puppet has its own way in this, 4 steps, so to say. First, define it, simulate it, enforce it, and then you have your report about the enforced state. So first step, define. For Puppet, you need the Puppet domain specific language. So it's a description language. One example you can see on the bottom. You can describe the relationship between different resources, and you can create really modular, reusable code. So you can use it for your environment, for your customer environment. Someone else can use your code, and someone else can provide you code. So not everything has to be done by you. The next step is to simulate it, to test it. This is one thing that is unique about Puppet. Okay, not really unique about Puppet, but not every solution can do this. You can simulate it, so you see what changes should be done, and you can so test and fix your modules before you really try it in production. Next step is to enforce it. It compares the current state and the desired state. It will change it to the desired state, and if it has reached this desired state, it will use idempotency. It's a mathematical an algorithm or a word from mathematics. It says that if you do something again, it always will have the same ending. So if you run Puppet code again and again and again, so no changes will be done. And also, if you have changes on your system, they will be brought back to your desired state, and this is something you really want. If something somebody configures something locally, what should be managed by Puppet, it will be overwritten, and so you always have your desired state, and you always describe the state and not the way to get there. And the last step, always changes will be reported, also the metrics, so you will know how long it has taken to bring the system to that state. And there are many different presentation formats for this. One here is Foreman. It will be providing you a graphical interface for these reports, but you also can use other ways, but I will tell you more about this later. So this was a brief introduction to config management and how Puppet does it. So my next and perhaps the biggest part will be to introduce you the different tools. First, for the tools, I will show you the workflow. It's always that the node is starting the workflow. On the node, there will be an agent running. It will run every 30 minutes in the default, but you can configure it, you can run it per cron, and so on. It will collect facts about the system, will report them or hand it to the master. The master will compile a catalog, will attend back to the node. The node will bring the system to this desired state, will report it to the master, and the master knows what report handler should be used and will report it to you, will present it to you. So every communication in this is encrypted by SSL. You will have your own certified authority for Puppet. You can also hand the certificates to Puppet, so when you want to use your own, but normally the Puppet internal certificate authority will be used. And so the first tool that we need is Factor. Factor is an open source library, also written in Ruby, provided by Puppet Labs, that provides the information on your host. It's also a command line interface what will return you the key value pairs. I have one example on the bottom, but also my system running. So if you type factor, you will see all the facts that are on the system. If you have synced some with Puppet, there's also a switch, and you will also get your custom facts, facts provided by your modules. And you will see there are many informations gathered with this. You can see the system, the hardware platform, configuration, like the network interfaces, and so on. This is one of the basic tools. The other way you can use it, is you can provide some fact you want, perhaps OS family, you can get this one. You always have the key, and the keys are also used by Puppet. These are the variables you can use. Yes, we will see this in use later. So one of the tools you always need, the other one is Puppet. Puppet is also open source, or you can say open core, because Puppet Labs provides his stack, its enterprise stack on it. We'll cover it this also later. It is a client server based program. You can also use it without the server, but in a normal environment, you will use it as a client server based. It uses a REST API on the server, so you also can use the REST API to get information out of it, not only for the Puppet internal use. The communication is secured by SSL certificates. It's platform independent, so you have the descriptive language, the Puppet domain-specific language. This provides the abstraction, and the providers for the different platforms will bring the resources in production, will bring them to the systems. So the domain-specific language, I have one example, the user on the right side from you. You have different resources, users and groups, files, packages and services, exec, so you can also run scripts from Puppet, and these are only some of the core types. There are many more. There are some for monitoring, so Nagios configuration. There are some for host entries, for cron jobs, and so on. And it's also possible to create your own. You can create your own by defining some in Puppet language. So you accommodate some resources and you create your own with that. And you also can write your own in Ruby to add them to the modules. There's only one rule. You need always a unique pair for the type and the title. So all must be unique for your one machine. If the machine is, or the different machines are using different code, there also can be the exact same name and type combinations, but not on one machine. So just to show you that example, I have not exactly the same because the user is also on my system. This example will create one user called test, will create its home directory, parameter manage home 2, it will create it, will copy the skeleton to it. And so if I apply this, Puppet is always one binary. The next is the command you want to do. And in my case, no-op to simulate. And the file, and to show something more output, verbose. And this tells me the user test is not present, but it should be. So to show ID test, no user. If I run it with no op, the user will be created. Or in this case, not. Don't know why it has run successfully when I tested it on another system, but no problem. Next example will do more, so it will also create the group and so on. But let me show you providers first. So the resource abstraction layer has, you have the different resource types and the different providers. In the example, in the on the slide, for file, there is used Ruby to provide the files. Packages, there are the different package types. Apt for Debian in OS family, YAML for the Red Hat family. There's also Zipper for the SUSE family, Jamz for Ruby code, and also low-level providers for Debian and Red Hat, DAP and RPM. For services, the corresponding for user, it will know that it has to use user add and the user add command for the pending to the system. So you don't know need to know how user add works on your system, and for changes not need to know user mod, because this is always something pain in the ass, because every distribution uses some other parameters for the same job. And so you can also use Puppet resource. Puppet resource user will show me all of my users. I also can add the username. So it shows me the same. User test is absent. I also can say the user test ensure present. And also this will create my user. This has created it just to prove. But it also can remove it. And the user is removed. So to do a little bit more with the Puppet code, I have a module user managed PP. It shows the user. It also adds the group. And for the user, it adds an SSH key, so the user can connect with it to the system. So when I try to apply this one, it shouldn't provide any mistakes, but also it will do nothing. This is because in the class I have created, it's only defined. The next step is to declare it. And this is done by an include. I also have just added it to the module, so I can apply it in one step. And you will see it will create the group, will create the user, and will add the SSH key. And you can see it will create the group first, the user second, and last the SSH key. If you have a look on my module, on my manifest, the user stands first, the group second, and the SSH key third. So not the order is what will provide the order what when Puppet will be run. In my case, it all is done by implicit dependencies, but you can and you have to add your dependencies to it too. So just to run and edit. Now we have my user test, my group test, you can also see, and it has created the home, and says also SSH with the authorized key. Just to prove it, it's the key from the type I have provided. So just to show you what can be done with Puppet, so you have an idea where we will get or for what we will do this. So you have seen the abstraction is the main part in Puppet. So for the real use, we should create classes from the different resources. In this class, you can also use syntax constructs. So you can use variables, but variables in Puppet are more like constants because you only can add the value and never change it. So one use, I think it's a constant, not a variable, but it's called variable. You can also use logical structures, so selectors, so you can use this one inline to give values depending on different facts or different values from the variables. You can use case statements. You can use if, else, if, else. You can create dependencies, so require and before will be only for the ordering, and subscribe and notify will also tell the subscriber, the notified resource, to refresh, so you can start services on changes of the configuration. You can run scripts on changes and so on. You can also use inheritance, so you can inherit different classes, but this one should be used only in rare cases because it's making readability very difficult. So this is one goal, the major goal of Puppet is to provide a readable code, so it's easy to understand and easy to reuse. And inheritance is something that works against it. The next level of abstraction is to group the classes into modules, and you also group your corresponding files. So a module will lay in your module directory, will have its name and some directories below that. Files is for static files. Lib, you can provide your own custom facts, functions, and resources. Manifests contain your Puppet classes. Spec is for tests. Templates for dynamic files. And tests is for the Puppet manifests that have the include in it. So someone can run Puppet apply, what I have run on the command line to test it locally. And don't need a server for it. And you also can add some more tests. You can provide and Apache with many V-hosts, and you can try to build and test for every parameter on your classes and so on. And so now I would like to show you with the different types of files. First, the static files are provided by the Puppet file server. It will transfer the files from the Puppet master. Perhaps it has a little bit wired syntax. So you can say the source is Puppet. So Puppet, the double point, double slash is a protocol. Then you can add the host name. If you don't provide a host name, it will try to get the files from the master you are talking with. And the next slash, modules, is a mount point. It's a magical mount point is automatically created by Puppet. You don't will see it in your files. If you want additional mount points to provide your own files, to have your own logic, you can add that to the file server configuration. So this is the other possibility for the part modules in my example. If you use modules, it will use the module name, and then it will know that the files will lay under files, so in the directory files. And you have to provide only the file name or some directory structure if you prefer some organization below the module. You also can use recursion on this. You can so provide complete directories with files, perhaps for your Nagios environment, something I know that, and I most times use it for deploying the plugins. You can provide a complete directory recursion on both sides, so it will manage the files on the server and provide all of them on the client, and will delete all files not included in the directory. But you also can say that recursion should only be remote, so you can manage a directory and all files from the master and at local exceptions too. So this is the part what Puppet can do with files. If you use Puppet with Apache and Passenger, Passenger is a module to run Ruby code in Apache. It will also be quite fast. If you don't do it, Puppet will run in its own web server called Webrick. It's a Ruby implementation. This don't scale. This will not run that fast, so it will not be good for providing big files. And also something you should think about it, if you really provide big files, the Puppet run will take all the time it needs to download those files. So perhaps you don't want to provide really big files with this mechanism. If you configure compression to the Apache, then yes, so instead, but normally no compression, just a call to the Puppet server and get the files. So I told you that you can provide custom facts, custom resources. There is no need to manually sync it. It's an option on the agent. If you activate it, you will see that all facts and resources, so types and providers that are added to your modules, will be synced, and not only that are on the modules on the classes you have added to your node, it will sync all. This will occur for the actual Puppet run, so facts can be used by the first run of Puppet. If you have to fix some providers or add some new, this will also occur before the puppet is run, so no errors will be shown because of that. Custom facts, custom resources can be created in Ruby. Custom facts are if you only need some information from a file or just to run a script on the system. You don't really need this Ruby know-how. It can be 3 to 5 lines of code, and this can really help to provide more information. Some customers of mine use it. They have their own file used for their deployment and so on, used for years now, where informations are collected, the location, the owner of the system and so on, and now we have created some custom facts for this. So one file going through the server info file on their systems and collecting all the information, and so they can be used in Puppet. Next, directory templates. The template function is executed on the server, so you always have to provide the file on the server. You have to provide your data, your dynamic data for the templates by Puppet, so you can use variables, you can use for these variables also the facts collected from the server. The templates are only a plain text file with some embedded Ruby code, so you have to use the Ruby code, the Ruby syntax for the variables, for conditionals. You can also do some iterations over the variables. You can have access to tags and classes defined in Puppet, and you also can use can make usage of Puppet functions. So if you have created something for Puppet, you can also use it in your templates. And the template function can also combine multiple templates. So you can provide your header and your specific specific body and also a generic footer again. And so you can combine this in just one function. And you don't need to provide different files for this. So I said, if you write the classes, there will nothing happen because they also have be to declared. You can do this on manifests. This one connects the nodes, the systems, with functionality, also the classes you have written. So for a single host, it can look like this node, FQDN, or the certificate name it is really, and classes you want to include. Include is one possibility if you don't have to provide parameters for the class. There is also a syntax, so you can provide parameters on that. I also want to show you later Hira, what can be used instead of providing parameters in the code. And yes, you also can use it for multiple hosts by using regex. So if you have a node web server followed by 3 digits and want to add some classes to it, you can use something like this. Also, you have a default node. This node should be defined, so you can provide your own custom error message or your default configuration if you like. It's just node default and Puppet code. Here I add a resource notify. It is a notice that is displayed on the console, but because it is a resource and always thinks the resource has a change because of the message, it will also be reported, so you can see this in your reporting collector, like the web interface or mail, if you want it. And yes, inheritance is also possible on nodes, so you can define a node base and a node web server, which inherits the base and the concrete node www.1example.com, which inherits this web server node. So this is some basics about Factor and Puppet. The next components I always want to introduce in one set. So basic GUI will add some functionalities. So functionalities you can get from GUIs is that you have your reporting target that collects reports, will graphically present you some these reports, and it will also introduce you to the mechanism, the external node classifier. So you have the mechanism to graphically declarate your nodes, and also external node classifiers from the GUIs add the possibility to create some groups, so you don't need inheritance for this one, and you can group it in the GUI. I will explain these two features first. Reporting is something you just need to enable on the agent. If it is enabled, it will pass the data to the server, and the server is a central stage will choose the target where to report. You can add one, but you can also add all of it, and you just add it as a target and configure the different targets. So for the basic GUIs, you just add reporting to the agents, add report HTTP or HTTPS on the server, and you add the URL where the reports should be sent to. For log, you provide your syslog facility where to log, tag mail, you configure a file with the tags that should be used, and the email address these tags should be sent to. Your class names are always implicit tags, so you can use this for grouping. You can also always add tags on your different resources, on your classes, on your modules, on your nodes, and so you can use this to say what email address should be addressed for what resource. You can use store, so the reports will only be collected in a directory on the server. You can use RD graph. This will provide you some graphs about the metrics, how many resources are added to the system, how much time it has to be taken to run the report, and you can choose PuppetDB. PuppetDB I will explain later. So you can also use multiple targets, so you can send mails for really critical systems and just get all reports to your web interface. And like everything in Puppet, you can also create your own. If you have your CMDB or your ticket system and you want your reports in this, you can create it in Ruby. It's always Ruby, but you also can do Ruby and also execute it, your own script in C or so on, if you want to do like this. The second, which the basic GUIs provide, or all GUIs provide, is some mechanism called ENC, external node classifier. There are two kinds of it. One is if you can run a script. The script has to return YAML. the YAML output you can see on the right side for you. Yes, no, left side. Just to switch. It's a script run with FQDN and returns the environment. With Puppet 3, the environment provided by the ENC mechanism is mandatory. And in versions below 3, the environment on the agent defined is mandatory. You can provide global parameters on this level or the classes that should be used for the system, and also parameterized classes with Puppet 2.7, I think, are possible. The other mechanism is LDAP, so you can use LDAP, but it has its own schema, so don't think about adding it to your Active Directory. It's a simple schema telling the system that it is a Puppet client, which environment, which classes, which parameters, and no way for parameterized classes in this variant. And if you use the external node classifier mechanism and you also have some local node declaration in a manifest, it will be merged. So you can provide the base in a node declaration file and add some classes on the ENC level. If you want to do so, you can do it, but I don't recommend it. And so the basic GUI, a really simple GUI, just providing these two mechanisms, is the Puppet dashboard. It was provided by Puppet Labs till about 1.5 years ago. Last version Puppet Labs provided was 1.0. And then it was deprecated, and Puppet Labs said they don't want to provide an open source web interface. It's a base for the Puppet Enterprise console, but they just want to work on the enterprise features. And so I think this year, second quarter or so, the community stepped up and just said, we fork it, we will provide the next version of it, and so it will give a Puppet version, a Puppet dashboard version 2. And it's not really released at the moment, but you can use it from GitHub. And the link below I've added is the presentation from the Puppet Camp showing the complete story about open sourcing, the dashboard, deprecating it, and community stepping up. So this one can be the GUI you just want to start with. I will show you more. Next feature we want to add to our Puppet environment can be orchestration. So orchestration is about centralized execution on multiple systems. So you have different solutions. You create your own by running SSR loops. There are many different solutions. Func, Factor, Capistrano, all of them use their own agents, use SSH to provide some organization. And there's one that is connected to Puppet, it's mCollective. It's something that uses also the facts from Factor. It can use the classes from Puppet. And so it's a framework that is provided by Puppet Labs. It's also written in Ruby. You can use fact Puppets and all the Puppet classes for grouping. It uses a middleware for communication. So you have to install an ActiveMQ, RapidMQ, or some other STOMP compliant middleware solutions. This is something that scares me from using it most times, because it's a layer I normally not need for administration. But if I really want a powerful mechanism for orchestration, mCollective is there. It provides some agents like this one shown below, packages. So I can ask about the package status, can install packages. In this example, it shows the status of the package httpd on all systems with a kernel Linux. So it uses fact kernel to look if the systems are Linux. It's a framework. Puppet Labs adds an agent for Puppet, so you can also create trigger Puppet runs. You can use Puppet resource abstraction layer and so on, but it's a framework. You really need to write your own agents if you want to use the power of mCollective. So this said, Puppet Enterprise Console adds live management, what is the GUI for mCollective, to the Puppet dashboard. It also adds auditing. One thing you also can do with the Puppet resources is not to manage them, just to audit it. You can audit everything about a resource. So you can say, I want to audit this configuration file. I don't want to manage it. It's just enough that I can collect the changes in my reports. You can say this configuration file must be for owned by this owner, this group, and must have this mode. And I just want to audit the content. So users can manually configure it, this system, but they can't crash it by changing the owner, changing the mode, and so on, because Puppet will correct this and just report changes about the content. You also can provide the content, so you can manage it and can audit it, but this will result in two reports, two changes, because it will report the change done by Puppet also. So what does Puppet Enterprise also add to the one is an enterprise console? It also provides you some packages that are completely independent from the system, because they bring their own Ruby version, the gems they need, the agent, the master, mCollective, and all this will be provided by packages from Puppet Labs used by their installer. And so you have a platform that is always running. It is tested by Puppet Labs, and so they can provide support for you. You can really get 24/7 support, 365 days a year. So if you need this, Puppet Enterprise will be the solution for you, and you will get the Puppet Enterprise console. The next, what you perhaps want to like to add to your environment is a deployment or provisioning solution. So Puppet needs to run the agent. So you need a running agent to use configuration management. And also the agent needs to run an operating system, needs to run and yeah, it's an operating system, so something has to be done before the configuration management can be used. So deployment is one step I really like to add to it. So the deployment of the system is done automatically, and it's done to the step where Puppet can be added, and Puppet can configure the system to the final configuration I need. So the solutions, every Linux system, I just added the example for Linux. I think it's also possible with Unix systems, it's also possible with Windows systems if you need it. I just don't know the examples because I'm more fit and more familiar with Linux. So Kickstart, Forel, Autoyast for SUSE, Preseed for Debian, Jumpstart for Ubuntu. This will be the low level. You create your files, provide it on an HTTP server, and provide your NFS, your packages, or provided by HTTPD, and you can deploy it. If you add some more logic, you can use Coupler, Kickstand, and so on, solutions that help you with providing the Kickstart files and the packages. The next solution is Razor, is something which is created for Puppet. I will show you next. Puppet Labs also has created a cloud provisioner, and there is also a open source front end for Puppet, which has added deployment to it. This is called Foreman. So this is the next three topics. Razor is also created by Puppet Labs in cooperation with EMC, or perhaps the other way around, because EMC is doing the main part. It's using a client. The client is a microkernel based on Fedora, should be based on CentOS in the next release. This is started by an PXE boot, so it will be provided by by DHCP. The server uses an REST API and an CLI to connect all the different parts. You have your host profiles, so if a system is known by Razor, it uses facts for it. So if the vendor is this, RAM is, the memory is this size, disks are this size, so this is a profile. It knows what operating system to deploy and what kind of configuration management should be used. It can use Puppet, Chef, and other solutions, so the policy has to connect these three types, and the system will automatically be installed. It's a nice idea, but at the moment it's rewritten and it's not production ready. Just to mention, production ready is the cloud provisioner by Puppet Labs. The use is to instantiate images on different cloud systems. So it can be used for EC2, so Amazon, VMware, OpenStack, and the Google Compute Engine. This is one part it can do. It also can install Puppet via SSH, but if I have configured SSH, I perhaps will also have configured many things more, so I think it's easier to configure Puppet and configure SSH with it, like the other way around. So I normally don't use this feature. It's nicely integrated into Puppet Enterprise, but it's also possible to install this modules on Puppet open source and use it. But it's only for using images. I personally prefer deploying a bare operating system, so I can do more changes and configure everything with a config management and don't have something pre-configured laying there for hundreds of years, so the history, and keeping all the old stuff. So I prefer fresh deployment. And this is what Foreman really can do. It's an open source web interface provided by Ohad Levy. Ohad Levy has done it to version 1.1 by his own. And then Red Hat stepped up and said, oh, we like the solution, we hire you, we buy the solution. And now it's developed by I think 6 or 7 people inside from Red Hat, and also by a big community. So Foreman is also a reporting target. It also provides you with an ENC mechanism, and it really adds a good provisioning solution. So Foreman uses so-called smart proxies to connect the GUI with the backends. So you can also configure your Puppet server, you can communicate with your Puppet CA. So you can assign the certificates from the GUI, you can deploy the PXE images for provisioning in the TFTP server. You can add DHCP reservations for the deployment also, and you can also add DNS records, but only pointer and A records in the deployment in the provisioning phase. And it also has some thing called compute resources that integrates virtualization and cloud provisioning to your front end. So you can add simple virtualization solutions like libvirt. You can use OVirt, Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization, VMware. These solutions will provide you with deployment for the complete operating system. The cloud providers like EC2, Google Compute Engine, OpenStack, Rackspace will instantiate images, so it can do both for you, can provide fresh machines and install the system, and also instantiate it pre-installed images. Yes, and bare metal deployment is also possible. There are plugins. One really interesting plugin is Discovery, so you can boot an image provided by the Discovery plugin, and this will will let the host appear in Foreman, and you can say, okay, this discovered host should be this host with this DNS record with this address and this Puppet classes on it, and this will deploy it for you. So I really like this solution. The next things I want to add is exported resources. If you have OneNote that creates your resource and it should be realized on another other node, so you need exported resources. This is be done with a database. There's so old classic backend for this. This is .configs. It's deprecated by Puppet Labs. It's working with SQLite and MySQL, but there is no further improvement. The other solution is Puppet DB. Something more to this in the next slides. The use case for so is exported resources, is perhaps host entry management. So you don't want to use DNS. For different reasons, it can be possible that you don't want to do so because you don't want to have so many DNS lookups. Also, you can do it, just say to every host he should export his host to the database, and the other hosts should create the host entries when the next Puppet run is done. A better practical example could be SSH key management, so you don't have to do say, yes, I know this host, and you also are sure that there is no man-in-the-middle attack, because so SSH keys are provided by Puppet, because they are exported from the one host when it is run, and they are imported, and so entries to the known host file are created by the Puppet agent run on the other system. Other bigger examples are monitoring. You can create your modules that add monitoring for the services, and if you run the one agent, it creates the web server and the web server monitoring configuration stored in the database. And if your monitoring server runs this agent again, he will add this configuration to his his configuration for monitoring. Also backup and other solutions, centralized services, the agents have to register. This are examples for this use case. So what is Puppet DB? It's Postgres SQL and Java-based data warehouse solution that is created by Puppet Labs because they said the old stored configs is too slow, it doesn't perform and scale so well, and they created this solution. The Puppet DB collects all the facts, all the catalog information from the last run from the systems. It collects reports. This is optional. You can say it should collect reports from the last 14 days, and you have all the information in one database. You can run queries against it. You can use these queries or the stored configs mechanism for the exported resources. And so you have your inventory service. You can use these queries and add it to a CMDB or to a report you have to provide for your customers and so on. So this is one feature you can add. Another feature what really helps to clean up your modules was introduced some years ago, but it really made a step forward with the standard integration in Puppet 3. It is Hira. It's also a Ruby library integrated in Puppet with version 3 and above, and also was usable as an add-on for Puppet before version 3. It's configured by a simple YAML file. You configure your backend. Backend can be YAML, so you can provide it by files. Also, backends are possible like MySQL, Redis, LDAP, you can create your own, you configure this backend and you configure your hierarchy. So you can provide some structure like I will use host-specific files, will use files specific by my location, and one common file as default configuration or fallback. And you provide files like this one on the right. You add information to the server, the common configuration, the proxy server, the proxy servers, an array that should be used for my class proxy, the parameter server, the YAML mirror should be an other in location in RC2, and the NTP server should always be this one in the common file, and the one in location should be another, and on the special host, perhaps it's the NTP server itself, it should be really different, so you can provide this, and you don't have to create this logic in your Puppet manifests, and you don't need to provide this, parameters, the data in your manifests. You have some reusable manifest. You can use it for every different environment. You can use modules provided by someone else because they can provide it because there are no information about their environment in the modules, and the data is separate and it's included in the hardware. So just to show and just to give you an idea. The next thing you always need is, well, you always will need is some kind of software management because of the providers for the packages and so on will need a defined source for the software. So yes, you will need your RPM files, your DAP files, the providers YAM, Zipper, apt-get need some location to get them. If you only have the internet as a source for it, you will really have a high traffic if you install it, it'll automatically update and so on. So also a good idea is to reduce it, is to have some software management, to have a local mirror and reduce your traffic. So it can be really simple. You can async in repository for your operating system. You can create your own. Perhaps here, create repo, the command for the YAML repositories. If you want something more, a graphical front end, you can use something like UpDN for Debian, Spacewalk, Red Hat Satellite, or SUSE Manager. It's more for this solution. They also have provisioning and monitoring in it, but you only need the software management part on it. And there's also two solutions that can do something with Puppet. These are Pulp and Catello, so I just only want to introduce them. Pulp is an open source Python repository management by Red Hat. The server can import and upload content. It can provide RPMs and Puppet modules at the moment. This is the thing what I like to say about Puppet modules. At the moment there was a change with Puppet 3.01, I think. So you have to downgrade to Puppet version 3 if you want to use the Puppet module tool, and mirror is a Puppet forge. One solution I will show later, where you can find modules developed by the community. And so you can create your own mirror for that too. You can publish it so it can be used normally without the client by publishing it as a web repository or by providing ISO images. And if you add the client to it, you can also do some server-side management. You can add repositories and add packages to your system, and you have a centralized reporting for what packages are deployed on the systems. And to get all this together, you can also use Catello. This will be the next version of the Red Hat Satellite. It's only usable for Red Hat OS family at the moment, but I think it will easily be to port it for other operating systems if they like. So perhaps SUSE will also jump on this. Pulp is possible to use for every content, so it's just in need of code for providing Debian files and so on. Catello is one front end that provides Candlepin for the subscription management on the Red Hat side, for Pulp the software management, and it also adds Foreman and Puppet for config management in one interface, and this I think is a really good idea to provide one single point of administration, one point to view, and so you can use this. So this was the first part of my presentation, so to show you the different components, different solutions, give you some ideas what kind of software you will need for your environment, what is the basic, what you can add optionally if you want. So next is what you should know when you design your environment. Just really some short ideas. So first, do I need support? Do I need pre-built packages? Do my operating systems I want to manage with Puppet have some packages in their repositories? Are the current versions or old stable versions which won't work with my perhaps won't work with my Puppet server, and so on. If you really need that and you want support, you want the pre-compiled packages, then will Puppet Enterprise be your solution? If not, you can use the open source packages provided by the distributions or by special repositories for your distribution. What's the best method for you to for reporting? Do you like it if you have a GUI where you can see it? Do you want emails? And so this is one choice you have. If you want a GUI, use Foreman, use Puppet Enterprise, use a dashboard. If you want emails, there is no need for a GUI at that moment. Do you want to use exported resources? So you have to use the old stored configs database schema and MySQL. Do you want the data warehouse solution, Puppet DB? You can use the Foreman function to nearly do the same when you use Foreman. Do you don't need it? So, this is one choice. Do you have a deployment solution and just need to add the Puppet package to it and some configuration so Puppet can run? Do you deployment? Do you want to do your deployment in your way you have done it before? Do it manually deploy VMware templates because another group in your, another team in your company is doing this. So, do you want the automation for deployments? And add some deployment solution to your environment. Use Foreman with built-in. Use Puppet Enterprise, the cloud provisioner, if this is the way you want to do it. Do you need some software management or is the amount of your system so small that you can use mirrors on the internet? If you want to use Windows and manage this with Puppet, you definitely want to have some software management because you have to build your packages and so on. So this is one thing you should think about it. Do you want to do your node declaration in files because you like to grab through it? You want everything under Git control also. This will be a point for using manifests for your node declaration. If you want to use a GUI, you have operating that deploys systems and don't really need to know about the systems. So you want a front end to use for the node declaration. You have your own database, like a CMDB, and you won't have a script that gets Puppet classes out of this. Or you just have plain text files that should be made to YAML output and so on. Think about this. And so you have the different solutions, what will fit the way you want to do your Puppet environment, want to use it. So this is one thing you should think about it, the choice for the different solutions. The other thing I really want to say is Puppet easily scales up, so just start simple and grow with your environment. The solution, so the rule of thumbs is just easy. The number of masters is the number of nodes multiplied by the catalog compile time is divided through the cores per master and the run interval. And so you have a rule of thumb how many masters you need. Most environments starting with configuration management, I think, start with a level you can provide only one single master. Perhaps because of difference in zones, because of availability, you just want to make it high available. You can also use it on a virtualization platform, which provides you the high availability, so no need for clustering. So just start simple, just start with one Puppet master and keep in mind you can grow. You can add more masters and yes, you can also add more features. What should be in your memory when you scale up? There should can only be or should only be one certificate authority. So you have to think about making this part of the Puppet server high available. But it's only needed for the registration. So no need for high availability if you don't grow fast, if you don't need deployment in 5 minutes later, the system has to run and has to be configured. So if this is not the need in your environment, so there is no need for making the certificate authority high available. You can easily load balance the Puppet traffic. So just provide a load balancer, and if you don't have a load balancer and it's enough for you, if some Puppet runs fails, if there is no is one of the Puppet servers not Puppet masters not running, you can also use round robin DNS for load balancing. But it's easy and dirty solution. If you have a GUI, the GUI is only required for the users, but if the GUI is also used as an ENC mechanism or report as your own reporting solution, perhaps it will always be required, so you have to think about making the GUI high availability or redundant on two different masters. And you also have to think about orchestration. If you have one Puppet master with ActiveMQ broker, you scale up, perhaps you have to provide a second message broker also. And so scale up is easy, but you should think about what is this I can load balance and what I have to make high availability. So one example, I know the slide is not that good readable, but I just have taken the picture from the training slides. This is one example for scaling up with Puppet Enterprise. You have your Puppet agent, the CA communication is routed by the one name to the primary server. All other Puppet communication and also the mCollective communication for orchestration is routed through the load balancer and is load balanced between the two different Puppet masters. The second Puppet master is so providing also the Puppet master functionality. So it provides the Puppet manifests and the mechanisms for the node declaration. It provides the ActiveMQ message broker. And this is all. There's no CA, there's no web interface, and no MySQL database on the second one. So in this case, the primary server should be high available, and scale up is more than for performance reasons and not for high availability. Because if the ENC mechanism is used, it always needs primary server. Yes. So, questions to about the design, the scale up. If no one asks questions, we will be finished earlier, I hope. So, next thing, some ideas you should have in mind when you design your workflow. First is the choice of editor. So I think two really good and really different editors are Vim on the one hand. You can have your favorite text editor helping you really good with Puppet. If you add the Vim Puppet add-on, you have syntax highlighting for your Vim editor. If you also add Tabular, you will have some automatic style guide conformity because it will bring everything to the exactly same line for readability. You can also add Puppet Lint and Syntastic to Vim. Puppet Lint is a tool for doing some tests for style guide conformity, and Syntastic will doing automatically syntax and style guide checks when you save your Puppet manifest. So Vim is a really powerful editor for German spoken people. We also have in blog netways.de some entries about this, and one colleague has made two entries about making Vim a powerful Puppet editor with this add-ons. Geppetto is the other thing. It's what is really powerful for doing Puppet manifests. It's an Eclipse-based EDE. So if you're writing Ruby code for your Puppet environment, Geppetto will be your choice. It adds the possibility to create Puppet manifests with syntax highlighting and style guide conformity shown in the editor. The module creation, you have some masks, some wizards that help you create your basic directory structure, some basic files, and so on. Yes, it's your choice if you want the text editor you use for your Linux system configuration, file editing, scripting, and so on, or if you want some graphical front end. So this is a first decision everybody can make for his own. The next is you should read the official style guide. The ideas about this guide are that you really should get to a really good readability. The guide, if you follow it, will help you to create modules that work with every feature and without every feature. And there are also always examples for the current Puppet versions. So it will show you the best practices, the style guide for doing something for Puppet 2.7 at the moment, because it's the current stable, but it will also show you examples that can be done if you are running on a Puppet 3 only environment, because you have this one and it will be easier to write modules with the new style and new coding possibilities. It will also try to create simple and robust modules, and also it is meant to create some shareable and usable by others, so that you can create your modules, and if they follow the guidelines, they are good enough to publish them on the forge, and others can download and use them. And what I really recommend is use this official style guide as your base and create your own style guide on it, because there are always choices how something can be done. And if some admin does this, is this way, other does it another way, and the third is it's the second third way, your modules don't will be really usable by everybody, because you always have to think or get the thoughts of the admin who created the module. So make your own rules, make your own decisions. Should I always use before, or should I use the require statement? So which way should I create my modules, say dependencies? And so this, I think, are some rules you can create for your company. And if everybody keeps on this, it will help you to have some modules you can maintain in the holidays of your colleague who wrote it. The next what you should think about is what kind of testing will you use in your in your development workflow. One thing everybody should use is Puppet Parser Validate to validate if it really is a correct Puppet syntax before he deploys it in the server and breaks the production. Puppet Lint style guide conformity checks are also a good idea. But perhaps some of these checks can be more optional for you. Perhaps one example, Puppet Lint throws warnings for lines longer than 80 characters. If you manage SSH keys in your manifest, the lines will be slightly longer than 80 characters. And so this rule will be optional for you. So perhaps it's not the best to really hard enforce every rule of Puppet Lint for your environment in testing. Something I really prefer is doing Puppet apply with no op on the test manifests I have written to simulate it. I can do it on my own Linux system. I can do it on the master, but then I really, really should never forget the minus minus no op switch because I can. If I have no ensure absent in my manifest and I have no test which removes all the other checks do and I forget the no-op switch, it is on my system and it's perhaps difficult to remove if I have deployed something really big on my master because I have used this one for testing. So if somebody writes Puppet code, give him his own development and test system. If it is his local laptop or if it is a virtual machine or a virtual machine on its laptop, I think everybody has an own an idea for the solution so someone can test the code. One possibility is Vagrant. Vagrant creates virtual machines. It works on VirtualBox. I think newer versions also work with KVM, but I'm unsure. You can create virtual machines and manage, configure them with Puppet, and so they can be used for testing. It's a bigger way of simulation because it always creates your first system, and so you really can test it without interferences with other checks you have done, something you missed on the system, forget about what you have configured, changed on it. And the last thing, I would say, and not everybody needs it, but if you do so, it really, really can help. Aspect Puppet. Aspect is an own language in Ruby. used by Ruby to describe expected results. So you can really describe what should it result if you include this class, this parameters, and so on. One example, a colleague of mine said to a customer, you don't use it, why? And they said, no idea, why should we use it? And provide us an example, and perhaps we do it. And so he created one example, and he's there for a migration at the moment. So migrating from Puppet 2.6 to 3.0, and there's one change in the LDAP function Ruby is using. So parameters are now always arrays, and because it is an array, and say cast it to a string in their Puppet module, there is now not matching the default, and not matching the different cases, and always falling to the default. And this is what he has shown with the aspect Puppet, what the test he wrote for them, and now he was doing testing all the week, and they have added tests for all modules in 1 week because they say, yes, in the migration, if we test it before, we don't will have the problems when we migrate. So it's a nice and a good idea to use it and describe the expected results and test with this feature. The next thing, you should always use a version control system. I say it so because I really think it's a must need for the Puppet environment. You can use it without, but if you have a config management version control under your config management, you easily can go down and up. It is different versions of your modules, and so you can easily disable some features that are not production ready, and so you can use it. Also, version control systems give you the ability to validate and review the code before the commit. If you use Git, Git is an solutions that is running the commit on the client and doing a push to the server. So pre-commit enforcing won't work on this solution because every developer is in his own it has to do it his own. If he adds pre-commit hooks or if someone forgets it, he can always provide some not valid code, so add it in the pre-receive, so the stage before it is pushed on the server. So this is the part where you want to add your validation, Puppet parser validate, Puppet apply checks to vagrant boxes, and if you add some solutions like Garrett, Garrett is a solution that steps between the push and actual commit in the server repository, and let you have some review mechanism. This can be a second colleague have to look and say, yes, this code is approved. It can also be the change manager. Yes, this is the code that should be in the change. And you also can use Jenkins or Hudson for doing some automated test. And then do it add as an another thing that is checked for the review, and then it is pushed to the server. On the server or on the version controlled repository. You can use post commit for the checkout in the different environments. I will say something in the next slide. And so you can also use the versioning of your version control system for having your change management something. You can prove this is a change that should be made on this event. And yes, these are the reasons I say you should always use a version control system with Puppet and with config management in every solution. The next thing you should think about is your staging. You always can use different Puppet masters for this. But it's also possible to use different environments on Puppet. The environments are just different directories on the server. You just provide different config lines in your Puppet conf. I just can show an example. The Puppet conf. I have three environments on my Puppet server: development, production, and one environment for my demo on creating the Puppet modules. And it's always, yes, perhaps maximum three lines of code, four lines with the header, the module path, the different versions of your modules. You can also have some module passes that are used in every environment. So here it's so used that there is one path for the modules specific to my environment, one for that are not in staging, that are always used in the actual version under common, and some for providing some server-side modules that are provided by my solution, so under user share Puppet modules. And the second you can see is config version. This is the other thing I want to mention about staging. You can always use this parameter to run your own script that returns your version string. So you can run a script that gets your git commit version that you always can say, okay, it's now running on the systems with this version string, and you can always say this commit was set with this change, and so you can always prove that it's really in that state that is approved by change management. And last one could be the manifest line if you don't use an ENC mechanism and want to have a node declaration by files that is also in your config in the version control and also on your system and differs between the different stages. So this is something you should consider. And the last and perhaps most unused and most unwanted part of your development workflow is documentation. Puppet makes it very easy to document. It has some inline markup. It's ad hoc markup that you can use for documenting in your Puppet manifests. It can be used for console outputs. You can use the Puppet document tool. It's Puppet doc and run against your module that can create your documentation. And it also can create you HTML files, so you can store it on a web server and have some documentation about your modules easily accessible for other developers, for your operating, and perhaps for your change management and so on. You also have some README file added to your modules. This README file is in Markdown syntax, so it's also a simple text file with some special characters for having headlines and special highlighting on the pages if you create some with Markdown. And this can create the README about how to use the module, what are the dependencies, and so on. And there's also a module file. It's human readable, but it's a simple key value file where you provide some information that is used by the puppet module tool, and this creates a JSON file that is used by the puppet module tool for dependencies, for installation, for the searches, and so on. And this makes it possible to add the modules to the Forge, but Forge is something I want to mention really later. So, some questions about the workflow, something you want to know at this stage? Yes, just ask.
What such staging, like testing environment and integration production? That means that you have to clone the agent on the other side?
If you really want to have the systems all running for in the stage, I recommend staging also be used for the staging. On the one side, you will have your test system for your test deployment of the application, and also, in my opinion, for your test deployment of the Puppet modules. Before this really use the staging, you can you have your tests, so it's valid code, and it's also it just goes the normal staging. But you also can say all my systems have the same environment production, because I don't care if it is testing. My testing systems are also frequented by the users and so on, and they all are productive systems by Puppet. And then I have to have some systems that are running in my earlier stages in Puppet to doing the tests with this one. Yes. So it depends on the workflow and on the on your definition of staging. I prefer staging doing really the same on Puppet side and on application side. So yes, my testing environment and for the application uses also my testing environment in Puppet. And so production development the same, but it's for your choice. It's how it fits for you. And you can also use different masters for that if you want. So you have every choice you want. Someone else? Yes.
These scripts into Ruby code or something like that, because now I have scripts
Colleague of mine also has created a function for this temp files, and I think it's also used in some similar functions are used in other modules that create random temp files for doing so. And perhaps if you really need so many different scripts and so on, there is one module, it's called Puppy. It's provided by example 42, and it's written for doing so. These things normally are not done by Puppet, deploying scripts and running them. No, only if you create your own type. So if you create your type temp file. Yes. Yes, really a difficult problem and no really good solution for it. Yes, I would do so either. So, so my last part. Yes. Claire? You can do it with Aspect Puppet if you do it this way around, write the tests for Aspect Puppet. I also have seen someone doing this with Cucumber. Yes, but Aspect Puppet will be the easiest way. And if you create the tests and then write or fix the module, it will be test driven. So I think. And what should I test? I always should test a module without parameters if it runs, or with a minimum necessary parameters. Should test it with different parameters. If I use defined resources, I always should run it with more than one on the same system, because defined resources are thought to use it more times on one system. And so, yes, you will see if some resources in the defined resource are not really good named, so it creates a conflict if you use this resource multiple times. But yes, it's really the same in like in every programming language. Try to think about every use case and try to write a test for it. And I always recommend to also write write a module that also can remove it. So if you install packages, also make your module possible to make them absent. So if a wrong deployment occurred, you don't have to redeploy your whole system. And so it's also good to test making the resources absent. So also create a test case for this. But I think this should also cover all. So next step, next part of the presentation, design your modules. Also first, so my ideas, what I have to consider about is where to start. When I have no no puppet in use at the moment, where should I start? What should be my first modules? I always say start with what is easy, what you know, or what is really a pain in your ass. Some good idea is to start with NTP, so every system is really running the time, SSH, user management, something you know for your environment, something that is really hurting you if it doesn't work, and something that every system should be configured. And then you will see the exceptions from it. Perhaps NTP should run other ways on virtual machines and so on. If you write your modules, think about the use cases. If you only have one homogeneous platform, you only use one Linux distribution, it's always the same. You don't really need to think about different platforms at that moment. You can use it without parameterizing, and you don't need to care about it. If you have different platforms, you're running Red Hat, you're running Debian, you're running Slash, or you're running different versions of one distribution, this can be this use case that you have to care about different platforms. You have to parameterize to config it in different ways. The next step is are there different roles for this software? Is there a server and an agent side? Is there only a minor change, a small adjustment I have to do for making this and doing another role? So if I have different roles, like server and client, I should create different classes for it. If I only need a parameter to switch between the different roles, I can use one class and parameterize this role. Perhaps an Apache web server on most systems it should run without SSL, on some it should run on with SSL, so I can add a parameter SSL, default it is false, and if I want SSL I say the class should include it on the systems with SSL support, yes, and it will run on the systems with SSL support. So this is one thing I should consider. One thing too is it one-time usage or do I need multiple objects of the same? Apache web server, I need multiple modules, I need multiple V hosts, so I should create this not as a class, because classes are one-time usage. I should them define as a defined resource, so I can use it multiple times and deploy multiple virtual hosts on the same system. A defined resource is a resource, and external node classifiers can only include classes. So, no. It's possible with a little bit workaround. You can use Hira for defining a hash. So you have a hash that will be looked up, and in your class you can run the create resource function. So you add this hash to the to the create resource. You use add the type of resource and the hash, and so you can create these resources. So this is a workaround for it. Really useful, colleague of mine using it for the vhost deployment on the hosts in a really big environment. So it really works good and scales well, and is a performance issue. So perhaps it's a solution for you. So the next thing I should consider is it really part of it, or should it be a separate module? One thing I have seen is on a customer environment that he has a subclass of Apache that adds ClamAV for the systems that have a download portal. The same, he has had a subclass ClamAV on FTP servers and also on mail servers. And so then the first system came that should be FTP server and web server. And so the one failed because of duplicate definitions. So think about, is this really a function, something that should provide this class, or should I use another module and just say I include it when the parameter on the class is set, or I include it additionally to the other class, and then it is configured in the way for running it with the other class. So think about this and define them as dependencies in your module. Perhaps a really bad example can be WordPress. I have seen WordPress modules that configure the Apache server, the database, so really installing the MySQL database backend. And so if you want to use your own solution for MySQL, you can't use this module. So this is something to consider. The next thing to consider is, can I use a template, or must I use a template, because I have to change some dynamic things in the file, or is a static file appropriate? And the last question is, do I have to write it my own? But before that, I want to show you some module. How it is evolving. I think everybody is familiar with Apache web server. So I have used this as an example. So my first idea, what I have I to manage when I use the web server. I have to install the package. I have to provide my config file, and I have to provide my service. So I just have to switch to my Puppet Camp environment. Where am I? Puppet environments, Puppet camp. So now I'm on the right location. So I have done my modules before. I have created 5 steps. So my first step, my first things I have made. So my manifest, it will always look for a file init.pp that provides the class with the module name. With the same like the module name, so my class httpd is in the module httpd in the init.pp. So I have to install the package, provide the file. So the file is also located there. So you can see. It is there, it is readable through the web server, what is running the Puppet server. And the service Apache should be running and it should be enabled for the system startup. So now I have to say that I want this module on my host Puppet Camp. So I use the ENC mechanism for that. I have added it. So the DNS environment here has brought my system in some trouble, but it has worked. So this is what the ENC mechanism returns for my host puppetcamp.localdomain. It adds my profile's default, this creates my user, adds my SSH key, gives me pseudo rights on this, yes, and I have added httpd v1. So if I run puppet agent -t for test, test is doing it verbose, one time, and no daemonize, so we will see the output. I also had should have added noops that we can see what it should be done and not also what it does. So. So, do I have lost my DNS? So, it tries to download the package and fails because the DNS has changed. And it tries to download the file. Yeah. So I think DNS is not working, so the environment here. This is why I don't like live demos. So I hope this will fix it. If not, so I just have to move from the VLAN to UMTS. I think that will solve it. So let me see. Sorry for that. So it now it's really working slow. No mirrors to try. So, it has worked fine. Ja, wahrscheinlich. So, I just will tell and don't show it really working. I hope you believe it. Because I'm also running out of time. So problem with this first module, you will see, you could see if I run it, there is no order. So the next step I have added was I have ensured the order. So now my file is downloaded from the server after running after installing the package, and the service is also started after having get the config file from the server, and using subscribe it will also recognize changes to the config file and restart the server. For Apache, I perhaps should also have changed the start, the restart mechanism to graceful from the normal service restart, but I haven't done this. So the next I have thought about was I also want to provide some index page for this system. So I've created a template for the index site. So use templates. And if it would have been run, the system would welcome us to its FQDN that will tell us that it's running on, in my case, CentOS. And because it is virtual, it will also tell us that it is powered by KVM virtualization in my case. So just to show the facts for this, is virtual 2 and virtual tells the virtualization environment. So the next thing I have thought, what should I do for Apache? I should run it on different platforms. So I have to parameterize it. Because I don't want to have my logic in my script that has the logic for what it should do. I have added another class, params, and this class does the parameterization. Yes, there is no default. So for Leonard, I add a default. Default fail not supported. So in my manifest, I only had to change the names to the parameters and inherit this parameter class. So it's easy to change the parameters if I want to support another platform and I don't have to mess up the original module with this. So now I have my basic installation and providing an standard index file. So what do I want to do next is I want to add some vhosts. So I have created a defined resource vhost. This creates the vhost configuration and document root. And I just changed my module that it don't create the default document root, and because I always want to have a default vhost, I just added the vhost with the FQDN and the priority of 0, so it will be the first in the tree, so it always will add this. And then I added one profile that adds the HTTP version 5 to my system and adds to vhosts and to host entries because I just wanted to show. But yes, networking yes, made me struggle. So I have created set all, but I had the decision to write my own. And also could do the other way, can use the Puppet Forge. It's a community platform for modules. So it's a web platform I can use, can search through. And there's also a command line tool that I can use. Perhaps it works. Puppet module search. So here I don't have it because it's an old version. Here I have it, yes. And it works, I hope. Don't want to wait because we have to leave at half. Module information on the site, the author, the project homepage, and perhaps an issue tracker, some tags that are added to the modules, the releases and the download count, and some test results. There are also running the RSpec test files on a platform and provides the test results in the description of the modules. So if I want to know if a module is good, it is useful, the first things before I look at the code, has the author added some more than this module on the forge? Is there an issue tracker? Are there issues that can match my environment? Is there the 0.0.1 release, or is it 1.6 or so? How many people have downloaded it? And so I have some indications for the quality of the module before I really look deeper in it and think about using it. One example for a good contributor is example 42. He has added 69 modules to the forge. More of his work is on GitHub. The modules always use the same layout. They all support nearly every Linux distribution and FreeBSD. All of his modules add monitoring as an optional feature, firewalling, and Puppet. This is his own script Puppy. This is his own script library, what also can do some kind of monitoring and some kind of automation. So this was about designing the actual modules. The next 3 minutes, this is will be enough. What you should also think about is if you design your modules, I have said classes abstract the different resources, the modules abstract these classes, and if I have then my nodes, so all the logic is on the node level. If I have a node declaration like this one in a file, there is many, many logic in it. And if I think about 1,000 systems using this many logics, this is not maintainable. So I should add some more abstraction. The first step would be to add some logic onto the modules, to abstract them, to separate the implementation, so how I implement the technology in my environment and the real what is needed by the technology. And so I only have the technology in the modules, and the implementation logic for my environment I add additional Puppet classes called profiles. So in this example, a profile for the application includes Tomcat, MySQL, and a special component A. Some different versions or implementation logics of this application inherits it and adds some additional classes, additional dependencies. And then I also can add another abstraction layer on it. So the profiles contain my implementation logic, and the roles contain my business logic. So no logic in the rules in the roles is added. So only a collection of profiles. So I say on the server with a role web application, I include my base profile, my custom application profile, and my test tools because it's a test system. And so the business roles are really separated from the implementation. And at the end, my node has only one role. Okay, in some environments, the nodes will have more than exactly one role. And so Puppet know-how won't be needed for the node declaration. So I easily can say to my trainee, deploy me some virtual machines with this role or for my operating. That should have do the daily business deploying systems. I can create a self-service portal for my developers that they can create their own systems and so on. And so this was my presentation. Questions and answers, because of the time, I will answer more questions in the front of the room. And if you have questions later, you find me and my colleagues on the conference the next day, and you find us on the internet, and always can email, can follow us on Twitter, follow us on our blog, and so on. So thanks for your for being here, for listening to me. Patience. Yes. So have a nice evening and a nice conference.